Hey you guys, and welcome back to another one of my videos. If you're new here, my name is Holly and thank you so much for watching. As always, I want to give a little shout out to my earrings. Today I have my Bubblo Bill earrings. I'm obsessed. They're from my friend's little business, the Aurora Collective, and as always I will link her below if you guys want to support a little small Australian business. But without further ado, let's get into this case. So today I wanted to talk about the case of Eurydice Dixon, and I really hope I'm saying her name right. I've heard it said a few different ways, but I'm pretty sure it's Eurydice. So Eurydice was born in Melbourne, Victoria on the 10th of November 1995. She was born to her parents Karen Walters and Jeremy Dixon, and I believe she had a younger sister also called Polly. I found her family really hard to track. A lot of the time on Facebook and whatnot, I'll be able to find relatives and stuff of people, but I could not find Polly anywhere. So I don't have any photos of Polly, I'm sorry, but I'm sure you guys won't mind. So Eurydice's father, Jeremy, is described as an anarchist and political activist. And I believe Karen, Eurydice's mother, was a political activist also. Sadly, when Eurydice was only 7, her mum actually passed away in a shopping center in Brunswick. And I believe the reason she passed away was because she was struggling with a heroin addiction. And she had been for quite a few years. Eurydice grew up in a commission flat in a suburb called Parkville in Melbourne, and she was described as shy, curious, thoughtful, and very kind. She was also funny and a very strong feminist. Eurydice attended Princess Hill Secondary College for high school, and I believe she got bullied quite a bit growing up as well, which is really sad. I feel like some kids can honestly be so damn mean. I remember some of the bullying that would go on in my school. I remember one time in maths class, one girl crawled up behind another girl she didn't like and she cut her hair off. And this is what I mean sometimes when kids or teenagers are really mean, like seriously. But regardless of the bullying, Eurydice had a plan. She wanted to study drama at Deakin University in Melbourne, and so she did. While there, she joined the Burwood Student Theatre Company, which is a theatre company run by the students at Deakin University. She played the part of Justine in an Australian written play called Cozy, and she was also part of the Moorland Theatre Company, which was an amateur theatre company which was based really close to where she lived. And within that theatre company, she played roles in plays that they performed around Melbourne too. So Eurydice seemed really, really happy. She had a bunch of great friends, and she'd gotten a new boyfriend by the name of Tony Magnusson, and she seemed to be really close with her dad and her sister too. When Eurydice decided that as well as acting, she wanted to dabble in comedy, she was supported by everyone around her, and she was good at what she did. When doing comedy, she would cover topics such as feminism and gender equality and other related issues, and people liked to watch her. Not a lot of people her age were brave enough to tackle those sort of issues in their comedy skits, and I really think that is one of the main reasons as to why she did so well. On the night of the 12th of June 2018, it was a Tuesday night, Eurydice was very excited to be performing at the comedy club at the Highlander Bar in Melbourne. She had recently started performing regularly, doing her solo performance, and on this night Eurydice was quite nervous because she was actually going to be performing some new material. But the performance went really, really well, and Eurydice was understandably just absolutely thrilled. She was so happy about this. You know, she put so much work into this performance, and to see it go well was just everything she wanted. She decided that after the performance, her and her boyfriend were going to have a celebratory drink at the bar, and so that's what they did. Her and Tony had a drink, and then at around 10:40 together, they decided to leave the bar. After that, they got some food, and then they made their way to Flinders Street Station. This is where they hugged. Eurydice blew Tony a kiss and then said she was gonna go for a walk, and they departed ways. It was about an hour walk for Eurydice to walk home, and I can totally understand why she did. You know, when you're just on such a high and you just want to like keep moving and thinking about what's happened and whatnot, I've definitely been in that situation before, and so even though the walk was an hour, I feel like on a night like the night that she had, it just sort of makes sense. When Eurydice was almost home, she decided to cut through a park called Princess Park. The streets on either side of the park were very, very well lit, but Princess Park was quite a big park, so it was actually quite dark in the park. So as she entered the park, she took off her socks and shoes and kept on walking, and she sent Tony a text saying, "I'm almost home, How about you? Sadly though, in the early hours of the 13th of June 2018, Eurydice Dixon would be found dead by a passerby at Princess Park between Royal Parade and Princess Park Drive in Carlton North. She had sadly been raped and strangled. The police were called and CPR was attempted, but sadly it was too late. Eurydice had sadly died less than a kilometre from her home. The police, thankfully, in this case wasted absolutely no time, and they found that the park fortunately had CCTV cameras, and within the day an image of a man that they were looking for who had been on that CCTV footage was released to the public. He had been seen walking reasonably closely behind Eurydice just moments before she died, and so understandably police wanted to talk to this man. So at about 6:30 that night, which was the night of Wednesday the 13th, a random guy, and you guys, I looked so hard to try and find the name of this guy, but I could not find his name anywhere. So for the sake of this video, we're going to call him Dave. So Dave was watching the 6:30 news and he saw a segment on the murder of Eurydice Dixon. And within that segment, they show a photo of a man who the police are looking for to have a chat to. And Dave is shocked because the person on the news is none other than his own friend, 19-year-old James Todd. So Dave obviously freaks out and he gets straight on the phone to call his friend James Todd to tell him that he is on the news in relation to the Eurydice Dixon murder. Todd then surprisingly calls the police and tells them that it's him that is in that photo. And he also tells them that although it is him, he was not involved in anything to do with Eurydice Dixon. The police though ask him to come in for questioning, and Todd gets his girlfriend of 4 years to drive him to the police station. And I believe his mother also met him there too. But before I go on, I want to give a bit of background on James Todd. So James was born in 1999 to his parents, and I couldn't find a lot of information on his family. After this case all came out, his family sort of went underground. They haven't done any press interviews or anything like that, but I did find out the name of his dad, whose name is Jason Todd. So James Todd was one of three boys. He had an older and younger brother, and him, his parents and his two brothers lived in a housing commission house in Broadmeadows, which is a suburb in Melbourne. This house has been described in court documents as an environment of rotting refuse, vermin and complete squalor. And I feel like even through this photo, you can totally imagine that. I mean, the house just looks so like there's just so much shit everywhere. At a young age, James Todd was actually diagnosed with mild autism and also ADHD. And it seems like he really acted out a lot in school, meaning that he had to change schools more than once growing up. Despite his behaviors though, he actually seemed like a reasonably normal teenager. He had a girlfriend and friends, and once he completed year 10 at school, he started a hospitality education and training course because James wanted to be a chef after he finished all his education. And he was actually still undertaking this course at the time when he came in to have that interview with the police. What James's friends and family didn't know though was that he was actually addicted to porn. He would spend hours at night watching violent porn, including porn where the female victim was depicted as dead or being murdered at the end. And it's interesting because we hear this in a lot of cases with people who will watch really violent porn like this, because as time goes on, they will find that watching it isn't enough and they want to do the real thing. So when James was first interviewed, he denied any involvement, and the police were just like, well, look, we're going to need to take your DNA to see if it matches with the DNA that was found on Eurydice, to which he just replied, don't worry about the DNA, I did it, I'll tell you everything. So through James's recount, as well as the CCTV footage, police were able to put together what happened in the early hours of June 13th, 2018. So that night, James had spotted Eurydice at Flinders Street Station and chose to stalk her for over an hour as she walked home. That day, Todd had been out with friends drinking and smoking basically all day. And when his friends had gone home, he had headed on the train to Flinders Street, and that is obviously where he saw Eurydice farewelling her boyfriend. And he chose then to begin following her. Police believed throughout the walk home he maintained about 15 to 20 seconds behind her the whole time. When she would stop, he would stop pretending to roll roll a cigarette in an attempt to feign legitimacy. So when Eurydice reached the third soccer pitch that she needed to go through on her way to get home, that is when James Todd sped up. There was no one else around and the field was really dark. He grabbed her by her hair and the back of her dress and he knocked her down. This is when he sits on her chest and he begins to choke her. Eurydice fought back really hard though. She scratched him all over his face and neck and chest. But sadly, she couldn't break free and knock him off her. He was just too much bigger than her. He was a really big boy. James then rapes Eurydice, strangles her to death, takes her phone and just leaves her there. James went to Royal Park Station where he sleeps for the rest of the night and he uses Eurydice's phone to inspect all the scratches that he's got on his face and neck. In the early hours of June 13th, he then attempts to return to Princess Park, but he's actually moved on by the police because the police are already there and it is now a crime scene. He then goes and casually eats a pie and drinks a coffee and makes his way home. And on his iPad at 6:37 a.m. he's seen searching Princess Park and he reads about the discovery of a woman's body there. At 6:57 a.m. he Google searches strangulation and rape porn. He goes through the results and continues searching for porn related to brunettes and curvy emo girls. That afternoon is when he gets a phone call from his friend Dave and turns himself in. In court, Todd pleaded guilty to one count of murder, rape, attempted rape, and sexual assault, meaning that there was no need for a trial. At the sentencing hearing, the Supreme Court hears about the circumstances and events leading up to the murder, which would determine the sentence given. The court heard that in the year leading up to Eurydice's murder, Todd had fantasies of violent and sexual encounters, and he had also choked sexual partners previously, and this had been with their consent, but he appeared to be looking for something more extreme. The court needed to consider that he had been diagnosed with both mild autism and ADHD as a child, and two experts actually weighed in at the hearing, and they agreed that Todd had something called sexual sadism disorder, and that was what drove him to rape and murder Eurydice. The defense asked the court to consider the fact that the murder and rape had not been planned. They argued that Todd was just attracted to Eurydice, but did not decide to kill her until the second it happened. Basically, if they can prove that Todd didn't pre-plan the murder, there is potential for him to get off on a lighter sentence. But despite all of this, James Todd was sentenced to life in prison and a 35-year sentence before he is allowed to apply for parole. In addition to this, James Todd was sentenced to 11 years for rape, 7 years for attempted rape, and 2 years for sexual assault, and must serve those sentences concurrently with his life sentence. So while he's serving those 35 years of non-parole, he's also serving the rape charges and sexual assault charges. So within prison, it has actually been recorded that James Todd is in protective custody, and I believe there's a few reasons for this. I think, you know, the nature of his crime is one of the reasons, but more than that, it is the fact that he has mild autism. He actually got a pretty hefty sentence, in my opinion, for life in prison, but I believe it is just honestly because of the brutality of the crime. At the hearing, Justice Kay actually said, and I'm going to read this part to you guys, "The sheer terror that Eurydice must have experienced is unimaginable. Eurydice was then doing what she and any other person in our society is entitled to do, namely walking peacefully in a public area of our city. She was vulnerable and in the circumstances, defenseless. In a most callous and cowardly manner, you set upon her, sexually assaulting and humiliating her before cruelly strangling her to death. You intentionally killed Eurydice Dixon by choking her to death in order to gratify your perverted and depraved sexual desires." James Todd has since tried to appeal the sentence that he was given, but it was dismissed because after being reassessed, they just did not believe that if he was to be let out any earlier than 35 years, he would not commit the crime again or a similar crime again. It was actually really interesting. In the documents that I was reading, and I will make sure to link them below, they said that his sexual sadism disorder would not likely be ever completely treated and fixed just because of the nature of the disorder. And to let him out would be a disservice to the community because they just did not believe that he would not commit a crime again. Oregon. Vigils were held all around Australia for Eurydice, the largest of which was of course at Princess Park, with up to 10,000 people attending. The organisers wrote on Facebook, "We should all be able to walk home whenever we want, wherever we want, and assume we will make it home safe. Our bodies are not for taking. It is not up to us to keep ourselves safe when we know it's up to men to choose not to inflict violence upon us." Households in Australia were encouraged, and many did put a candle in their windows or leave their porch light on in memory of those who, like Eurydice, never made it home. Eurydice's death was truly one that shook the nation. It was met by an outpouring of grief and anger from men and women alike who live every day with the fear that the same thing could happen to them. In 2018, it was reported by the 25th week of the year, 29 women had lost their lives by a violent death, amounting to more than one woman a week. This is just honestly so heartbreaking, and it is truly one woman a week too many. On the 17th of March 2019, the Victorian government announced that they would be doing an annual $5,000 stand-up grant for rising female comedians in memory of Eurydice Dixon. Susan Proven, who is the director of the Melbourne International Comedy Festival, said the stand-up grant is inspired by the promise and ambition of Eurydice Dixon, a much-loved emerging comedian whose friends remember her as brilliant, brave, and beautiful. Unafraid to delve into challenging material and a big, bold laugh that would fill the room. And with that, I come to the end of this case. I will link some relevant resources below if you guys want to check them out. And I just wanted to add a thank you to everyone who watches these videos. I really enjoy making these ones, so the fact that they get a lot of support really means a lot to me. And I've noticed recently that there's a lot more of you subscribing to watch these sort of videos. So yeah, thank you guys. I see you subbing and it makes me so happy. So yeah, from the bottom of my heart, thank you. I've got a few more cases coming and they are really wild. So I'm really, really excited to share the next one with you. But as always, I hope you guys are having a great day wherever you are, and hopefully I will see you in my next one. Bye, you guys.